clear-eyed, thoughtful, and I'm particularly interested to hear today how he will address what has been a concern. How does this administration, in its authoritarian impulse, how must the media respond to that reality, rather than just repeating falsehoods that are injurious to our democratic life as a society? And I know no one who is as well prepared to answer that question than Lawrence O'Donnell, who, of course, speaks to both the ideals and aspirations as well as the demons and villains in our politics. In addition to his tenure on Senate staff, he was the Emmy Award-winning executive producer and writer of The West Wing, which we cherish. With that, I'm so honored to welcome Lawrence O'Donnell as the fourth annual Richard D. Hefner speaker.
I'm going to disappoint you. I don't have anything as good as Al Pacino cutting off arms or Clark Gable's bare chest. And I have to immediately say these two very, very important words, Aaron Sorkin. Aaron Sorkin created The West Wing and allowed the rest of us to play in it for 7 years. Aaron was the creator, original writer, executive producer of the West Wing series, and I've just been hearing from Steve how he's been showing it to his kids now to say this is this is the way the presidency is supposed to be. And of course, in the age of Trump, you have to turn to fiction to see what the presidency is supposed to be. But I did become an executive producer writer on the show starting the first year. And we all still miss it. And so I'm looking forward to the question and answer time. And I'm just gonna deal with the first question right now. We do not know if there will be a reboot of The West Wing, okay? That's the only honest answer. And the president of NBC is constantly dangling it out there and talking to us about it, but it's a very hard thing to put together, and we'll see. To talk about the news media in the age of Trump is to talk about something that you are all as well versed in discussing as I am, because you are part of it. You are the consumers of it. You are the judges of it. You are the victims of it on many situations. And so I'm going to talk a little bit about what the job was before Trump, because what you're watching is a job in transition. That is to say, political news media coverage in America is in transition. It is doing things it has never done before. It is facing challenges it was not ready to face and did not know how to face. And I want to talk about that a bit. I don't get out much, so it's going to be much more important for me to hear from you maybe than you realize, and so I want to get to the questions as quickly as possible, because what I do every night, I do alone in a room. I'm not going to count Bernie, the camera operator, because he never pays attention to he doesn't care what I'm talking about, okay? Unless it's a joke, I'll hear him laugh. But I'm basically alone in a room, and I never see, there's a couple of million people watching, I don't see one of them, and so I don't have any sense of what your experience of all of this is, and it's important for me to hear that. I want to begin with this, and that is what you must recognize at all times, and maybe you by now realize, political journalism is the absolute least effective worst form of journalism we have. It is the worst. The best is sports. When they tell you that this many pitches were thrown in the game, this many hits, this many home runs, this many foul balls, it's all exactly right. And when they tell you who gets credit for hitting the home run, they are exactly right. When they tell you exactly whose feet crossed home plate and scored a run, they are exactly right. They're never wrong. Never. And you get to check them because you can watch the game on TV. It's very different from when Ronald Reagan was a football sports announcer on radio, where he literally would say, later he would say, I couldn't keep up with it sometimes and I just make stuff up. Or he would leave out big plays because he was looking that way and someone fumbled and he couldn't do it. But he said, on radio you could get away with it, and television changed all that. So television or sports journalism in general is your very, very best journalism. Second place goes to financial reporting, but only at a certain level, meaning that really is the stock price. It really did go up, it really did go down. As to why, well, that's much more mysterious. That's kind of what the argument is about. And then that brings us to political journalism. Bob Woodward, who has been at this longer than anyone, has a passage at the beginning of all of his books, which says, this is the best available version of the truth. Available is the key word. It's not the truth. It's the best that was available. Meaning, of all the people I, Bob Woodward, talked to about what happened, this version of what I've assembled here is the best version that I can come up with. And Bob always leaves open to history that there will be a better version, that someone else who was in the Oval Office that day, who Bob Woodward did not get to interview, will come along and add something to that scene that changes it entirely. So best available version of the truth. To equate political journalism to sports journalism, imagine if we scheduled the Super Bowl, and the way we did it is the players, and this is a little bit of what happens. For a couple of weeks, the players make speeches about what they're gonna do. And there's all this boasting about, I'm gonna score 10 touchdowns, and I'm gonna, grab 5 interceptions, and I'm gonna, set a record of, gained yardage and all this stuff, right? I'm gonna kick the longest field goal in history. All these kind of bragging promises about what they're gonna do. Sounds like politics, right? But in sports. Then to play the game, to conduct the Super Bowl, we will usher the teams into a stadium, we will lock the door, we will not allow a single camera in there, we will not allow a single spectator, we will not allow a single member of the family, not any member of a coach's family. It'll be nothing but the teams down there in that stadium, and they will come out 3 hours later and they'll tell us what happened. That's the accuracy level. That is exactly the accuracy level you are dealing with in political journalism, in the coverage of campaigns, and in the coverage of governing. And it is much worse, sad to say, in the coverage of governing, because governing is far more complex than the coverage of campaigning. One minor example about that, about the complexity of the politics of governing and the coverage of governing. Trans-Pacific Partnership is something that has never been discussed in any detail on any cable news show at any time. Donald Trump was against it in the campaign. It was covered as an issue that Donald Trump was against. Bernie Sanders was against it. They were echoes of each other on that subject. Hillary Clinton turned against it after being completely in favor of it because that's where the political wind was blowing. But there was never any coverage of the issue. There was just the coverage of, oh look, Hillary's turning to the Bernie position to pick up this amount of support. The Trans-Pacific Partnership is the alternative to what you're watching now, which is the beginnings of the very first 21st century trade war, conducted by a rank ignoramus who never knew what he was talking about when he said he was against the Trans-Pacific Partnership. He didn't understand a word of what the Trans-Pacific Partnership is about. He doesn't understand what international trade is about. He doesn't understand any of the dynamics of it. And having worked in government, I can tell you it is the single most complex governing issue I've ever encountered. When I was running the staff of the Senate Finance Committee, we had jurisdiction over taxation, which is pretty complex, Medicare, Medicaid, welfare, Social Security, unemployment insurance, and international trade. And I can tell you that there were, of the 20 Senate members of that committee, there were only two who, to my mind, understood more than half of what the staff knew. Which is okay, you want a government, I promise you, you want this. You want to have staff who know much more than your senator. That's who you want. You don't want staff who know less. That's not gonna do you any good. And these international trade staffers on the Finance Committee are experts on this, and they spend their lives on it. So yes, they know more than the senators. But your Senator Bill Bradley and New York Senator Moynihan were the only two out of the 20 on that committee who made a real effort to understand the subject and got to the point of understanding what I would call most of it, but not 100%. It is by far the most complex subject. We don't cover it. We do not cover it at all in the news media. And so that horse race thing is what our, what did Hillary say about it versus what did Bernie say about it is the depth of our coverage. That model failed us, and all of the techniques of political journalism failed us when the really big test of it came. And the really big test of it came not when Donald Trump decided to run for president. The really big test of it came when Donald Trump told the foundational lie of his political career. That very first lie, the thing that got it started. It was the most important lie he's ever told, because it was the lie that endeared him to this group of Americans we now call his base. They loved it. And they loved it because it reached them where their hatreds live. That is the most passionate way to reach someone. And that lie was about President Obama's birth that he started telling in 2011. And the first time he talked about it, the very first time, I called it a lie. I was the only one. And the reason I was the only one, for years, for another 5 years, I was the only one to use that term. The reason was journalism, political journalism, was never empowered to call anything a lie. There were two sides to everything. Tax cuts are good, tax cuts are bad. Here's the Republican side, here's the Democratic side. Neither one of them are lying. And by the way, they weren't. I mean, you could say they're fudging the data at certain edges of the argument, but they weren't fundamentally lying about what they were saying. It wasn't about lying, it was about argument. The political news media had absolutely no capacity to call a lie, and it was in fact specifically against their rules. They were not allowed to. I had never read the rule book, I didn't grow up in it, and so I didn't really concern myself with it. And Donald Trump learned a lot in his foundational lie. He saw how it worked for him, and it was very, very simple. He would tell the lie, and the interviewer would not seriously challenge him on the lie, would not ask, can you prove that you have investigators in Hawaii? None of them asked that. Everyone who he said, I've sent investigators to Hawaii to find out what's going on, they just nodded. They just assumed he sent investigators to Hawaii. One of the trick questions here is, let's try to think of the person who did the toughest interview with Donald Trump about President Obama's birth. And that is a trick question, because I'm afraid no one did. Not one person. For years. Donald Trump not only got away with it, he got offers to be on more television shows and lie about it some more. Because what they noticed when Donald Trump came on in those 15-minute blocks of ratings that they get the next day, oh look, the Trump block went up. When Donald Trump came on yesterday morning to lie about the president's birth, the ratings went up. That means they want him to come back. Donald Trump discovered that. He also discovered the fundamental politeness of that kind of forum, which is, we don't really want to interrupt people. I mean, we do it, but we do it when we're kind of forced to and we're running out of time, but everyone's trying not to. And he's someone who, once he sees there's politeness in the room, he's gonna just, you know, steamroll his way through that politeness to his objective. And so he would go on, you know, the Sunday morning shows. And he knew, he had watched them enough, he knew how it works, that they will ask me something, I only have X number of minutes, and I will just fill it up with words, and they won't really interrupt because they're polite on Sunday morning, and I'll steamroll through it. And what he discovered to his joy, the ratings of Meet the Press will go up because Donald Trump is on. The ratings of Face the Nation will go up because Donald Trump is on. And so what that meant was that the mission of every single Donald Trump TV interviewer, when he was lying about the president's birth and after he became a candidate for president of the United States, every one of his TV interviewers had only one objective in a Trump television interview, and that was to get the next Trump television interview. And there's only one way to do that. You better not make it hard for him. You better not challenge him. And Donald Trump is one of those people who can smell where the challenge is. So there was this image of Trump during the campaign that, oh, he goes on all the shows, he talks to everyone, not even close to true. Went on all the CNN shows, went on all the Fox shows, went on only a couple of the MSNBC shows, wouldn't go near Rachel Maddow, never spoken to her. Wouldn't dare, not 2 minutes with Rachel, never. You know? And not only would he not come on my show, he threatened to sue me on Twitter. And I said the worst thing you could possibly say about him, which is he's not as rich as he says he is. And that he immediately sent out the tweet that he was going to sue me, and I begged him to sue me because I wanted to get him in discovery and all that. Of course, but what he would do as often as he possibly could is go on the 10 p.m. show on CNN with Don Lemon or whoever was doing it, specifically because he knew he was going up against me in the ratings, trying to hurt me in the ratings, and it did. It hurt me in the ratings, and he'd do the 10 p.m. show at Fox all the time. And so the news media had no tools for this, absolutely no tools. And they caught up to it very, very slowly. The very, I'll never forget it, the very first time I held a New York Times in my hand with the word lie printed beside the word Trump was in September of 2016. Less than 3 months away from the presidential election. After having allowed this infection to grow and grow and grow since 2011, when he started talking about the birth certificate. Within the same week, I held the LA Times in my hand, and the front page, there was Trump and the word lie printed for the very first time. That's when they caught up. That's way, way, way too late. Way too late. And so, we have a President Trump because the 21st century political news media was using its late 20th century tools. And those tools were no good. Those tools were no match. And we are now seeing something that would horrify Dick Hefner, because the notion of having, of Dick trying to do what he did today and calling his show The Open Mind, the minds have closed now. The minds have closed around politics in this country. Mm-hmm. And they have closed into camps in ways that didn't exist when you know, Dick started thinking about these things and when Dick was thinking about these things in the 1960s. In 1968, for example, if I told you I was a Republican, you would not know. Would not know if I was a conservative or a liberal, especially in New Jersey. If I told you anywhere in the country that I was a Democrat, you would not know if I was a liberal, a conservative, or a segregationist. If we're in Mississippi, Alabama, the likelihood is I was a segregationist in 1968, if I told you I was a Democrat. Now, when we hear that word, when we hear the word Republican, we know you're a conservative. There is no such thing. The liberal Republicans have become extinct. And it's also why the independent slot in our voting rolls has expanded so widely. It's because so many people do not identify as one or the other of these things. And each party has become a minority party. Each party is way less than 40% of the public. And so we have minds that have been closed, and reopening them now is more difficult than they have ever been. And that's why discussing the news media in the age of Trump in a university setting is so important. Because we have come to the point where a governing portion of our electorate, because remember, it's the electorate who governs. It's the electorate who casts the votes that put those people there. And a governing portion of the electorate no longer has to be a majority. And we've discovered statistically in this country it never did have to be a majority, but we didn't really know that until 2000. When we saw the magic of the Electoral College at work for the very first time. And then we saw the Electoral College do its magic again in 2016, where the person with the least votes, comes in second place, becomes president. So a governing majority of the electorate is 46%, something like that. And we now have a governing majority of the electorate that cannot tell the difference between fact and fiction, cannot separate fact from fiction. And that is the mission of education. And that is, of course, the ultimate goal of the great institutions of higher education like Rutgers. Our oldest university in America has a one-word motto, and it's truth. Veritas, one word motto. That is what the university is pursuing, is truth. In science, in social science, in all subjects. That's what it's always been. And one of the failures of American journalism in anticipation of the age of Trump was the segregation of subject matters and beats, the beats in reporters' lives. You know, this one's on the police beat, and this one's on the politics beat. And we do it physically with newspapers. Here's the sports section, here's the business section, here's the, you know, general section. And the problem is that in the education beat, for over 50 years, we have been talking about, in small ways and then increasingly large ways, what has been described in journalism as a decline in the quality of American public education. I think Time magazine did its first cover story on this about 35 years ago, the decline in the quality of public education. There's a lot to debate about, number one, whether that's even happening. There's a lot of idealizing of what public education was in, say, the 1920s or 1930s. People are forgetting
that, you know, in West Virginia in that time, you had teachers who actually couldn't read and were, you know, teachers in schoolhouses there. So it's complex. But let's just grant that one thing that is happening as this population goes up over 300 million is that in raw numbers, we are delivering more ill-equipped people out there into our civic life and into our work lives, ill-equipped to handle the challenges of the 21st century. Some who are ill-equipped to handle the kind of computer skills you need to get certain kinds of jobs. And at the same time, I just want to say this parenthetically because we are at Rutgers. The top end of our academic achievement in America is as good as it has ever been, and everyone who's involved in it will tell you it is better. You know, the admitted class at Harvard College this year is academically stronger than the admitted class at Harvard College 35 years ago or 40 years ago, and that's true all over the country. And American public schools are still delivering two-thirds of the admitted class to schools like Harvard and others all over the country. So at the high end of achievement, I just want to make that clear to all of us. The system is working wonderfully and in fact better than it's ever worked. But in the masses, there's a different condition out there. But because journalism segregates subjects, the politics section has never read the articles about the weaknesses in our public education system and the weaknesses in our mass education system in this country. But if there's a grain of truth in the decline of public education in America over a 50-year period, you cannot claim in the 21st century that you have produced an electorate that is intellectually capable of managing all the issues that they have to evaluate when it's time to choose who should be the president of the United States that runs the largest healthcare system in the world called Medicare, and the largest retirement pension system in the world called Social Security, and the largest military in the world, and the largest set of international trade relationships in the world. The capacity to sort out those issues and make intelligent decisions about them is not there if you've been reading all those articles in the education section for 50 years. But we must always pretend in political journalism that the American voter is all wise. And so when the American voter votes for a segregationist, as they were doing, you know, for George Wallace in 1968 when he was running for president as an independent, the mission was to go out there and talk to those Wallace supporters and find out why they're voting for him. You saw there was a certain obsession that occurred in the American news media after Trump won to cover the Trump voter. And the mission of it was to make sure that we covered the Trump voter in an understanding way, a way that found out what was it that moved these voters to Donald Trump. And it completely ignored all of that coverage, willfully ignored all of the racist elements of the Trump candidacy, and all of the trademark madness of the Trump campaign, and tried desperately to make the Trump voter fit into a rational box. And look, some of them do. I mean, a lot of them do. More than half of them do. And I completely respect that choice, and I mean it. If you believe that abortion is murder, if you are opposed to abortion in all of its forms, then you should always vote for the Republican. I get that. That makes perfect sense to me. That is a rational choice. If you believe that you always want taxation to be lower and you don't care what happens to public finance or the deficit or the debt, if you firmly believe that, then you should rationally always vote for the Republican, because you will always get that from the Republicans. So there's a whole set of rational voters there. If you're one of those people who's desperately afraid that, you know, Obama and his friends are coming to take your guns, if you have that irrational belief, it is a rational voter choice following it to vote for the guy who says, I'm going to make sure you get all the best weapons of war you can possibly want to have in your home. So there's a rational set in there. But obviously, in the Trump voter, there were people who believed that Mexico would pay for the wall. That is a failure of education. That's all it is. It's just a failure of education. If you believe Mexico would pay for the wall, it means you were not educated to the point, which should be high school, to know that that's impossible. You know, and so on with a bunch of other such Trump proposals. And so the news media's challenge is being met very, very slowly. They're in a spot now that I'm encouraged by. They wouldn't fail the same way again. But it's too bad that they had no tools available to them when 2016 rolled around. And it's been a very painful learning curve to watch them go through. And the bigger challenge, the one to which I have no idea, absolutely no idea, where to look for the glimmer of hope, is what Donald Trump so gleefully called the less educated voter. When he won the Nevada primary that night, the category in polling that showed up strongest for Trump was what the exit pollsters that night were calling the less educated voter. And Donald Trump, in his victory speech that night, said, I love the less educated voter. I love ignorance. And he thrives on it. He needs ignorance. He can't exist. Well, he lives in a fever of ignorance 24 hours a day, and he relies on people who live in a similar, you know, mental posture toward these issues. And I don't know how the educational system changes that. And it is the job of the educational system to do that, because by the time you get to us, you know, by the time you're old enough to vote, and you turn on cable news, and you listen to Rachel Maddow, or you listen to Sean Hannity, there's nothing we can do if the educational system hasn't delivered you there with the ability to separate fact from fiction. That is my music cue to take questions from the audience, which I'm going to do.
If you don't mind, I think this is probably going to be, it's a big group, so I think we'll need you to come to the microphone to ask your questions so everybody can hear it.